Hello, and welcome to another edition of Anderson Extra, made by boiling down cassettes of the Gerry Anderson Show as broadcast on BBC Radio Ulster. We strained it through Sean Coyle's eyebrow, and when it dried out, we had enough material for 25 minutes. What's your name? If the army was reporting you, what'd they call you? Sierra Cobra? Is that who you are?
Sierra Charlie.
Sierra. Well, I'm
a man called it to me the other day.
Sierra,
Sierra Charlie, what about you?
Well, I'm told that I'm Golf Echo Romeo Romeo Yankee. Did you know that? That's Gerry, of course.
Golf
Echo Romeo Romeo Yankee. I can hardly say that. Golf and you're Sierra Echo Alpha November.
Yes.
No, I'll just call you Nov for short. Sierra Echo Alpha November. And dear Gerry, phonetically Golf Echo Romeo Romeo Yankee, much better than Sierra Echo Alpha November, this man says. Anyway, it's a letter. Sorry, it's okay.
Did I tell you the story about the number plate in my car?
No.
I had a Morris Minor car.
Yes.
Many years ago.
When the
place was full of checkpoints and this, that, and the other.
During the Troubles.
And it was YZ, something, 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 something. But I was always Yankee Zulu.
Yankee Zulu went to town.
You see? Yes. And the front number plate fell off.
Right.
One day, you see? Uh-huh. So I had to get a new number plate. So I went and I got the words Yankee Zulu on the number plate.
Did you?
Yeah.
How did you manage that?
I just went to the man who makes the number plates and I says, I want a number plate. And he says, what do you want? I said, I want Yankee Zulu. Spell that out. Write that down, Yankee Zulu.
And then you had the number after.
And then the number after that.
Like, say, 1532 or something.
Whatever it was.
And yeah, that must have confused the squaddies.
Oh, they loved it.
Did they?
They called all their fellas over. Said,
yeah, yeah, mate, look at this. You know what I mean? Bloke here.
But apparently it was Yankee illegal.
Zulu.
But apparently it was illegal. And I'd like to take this opportunity now, Gerry, of apologising to the police if I broke the law in any way. I thought it was a joke. And I throw myself at the mercy of the courts.
I've got to make a citizen's arrest and run you in.
No, but it was many, many years ago. Now, there might be a time lapse now. There might be something I can get underneath the door with.
Let me give you the details pertaining to this programme, as I never bothered to do that at the start of the programme. And remember, there are new listeners all the time replacing those who die. The number to ring if you want to...
Because the gentleman pointed out the fact...
Can't you hear me giving out the numbers?
No, the very fact you mentioned new listeners all the time.
Yes.
A gentleman on that subject, the gentleman pointed out that every time you tell the story about your father and your father asks for a particular tool, it's always a different tool. Is that for the new listeners?
Yeah.
So that's why it's always a different tool.
Yeah, but you can't be telling the same story all
that's
the time.
Okay. Oh, right.
Because it's different, you know, people hear a different tool, you know, they get their picture. Right. Okay. And they say to each other, I bet you'll say a screwdriver now.
Yeah.
And I don't.
Yeah.
I say something else.
Yes.
Keeps their attention.
See, the last time it was a spanner.
I know.
There was a screwdriver this
morning. I know. It'll be a saw tomorrow. It'll be a plane on Friday.
Had you the strength to use a plane?
I had the strength to use a plane.
No, you hadn't. You were a weakling like me. You're a little tiny puny boy. I couldn't plane. Did you ever try planing the bottom of a door?
Can you chisel out a dovetail joint? Come
no.
on.
No.
Can you?
No.
Can you bevel?
No.
Eh? Huh?
No.
All right, don't talk to me.
But you,
I'm a beveler from way back.
Is that wood?
That's wood.
I remember cutting a piece of wood once. Where I don't know, somebody wanted me to cut this piece of wood, my wife or somebody. I think we were putting up curtains. You know that thing you put the curtains on?
Yeah, like it's a curtain rail.
But you know that board that sticks under the wall?
Pelmet.
No, Pelms, I think.
Doc, stop!
Anyway.
Go ahead.
Anyway,
nothing's good enough for you.
I got this bit of wood, and I measured it, and it was too long for the window. So I held it up, you see, and it was sticking out each side. I cut each end off.
That was very brave of you.
Do you know what I mean?
I know what you mean, yeah. It was a big decision on your part, yeah.
Yeah.
I bet you felt good after.
But a normal man would cut one end off and make it fit. Do you understand? I cut both of them off.
I took
you a long time.
You see, I didn't see anything wrong with that. So I would have done that too. As well as being a star broadcaster, the presenter is a celebrated author specialising in a series of autobiographical works that are mostly untrue. Here he defends the good bits. Who's on here now?
Andy.
Hello.
Where is he? Oh, Andy, hello. Sorry, Andy.
Hello,
how are
I thought
you?
I never was going to get speaking to you then.
Ah, don't be cheeky. We've got a programme to run here.
Listen, I've come on to be nice to you and compliment you on your book, Heads.
Well, thank you.
I've got up to chapter 10 and I'm really enjoying it because I've been laid off. This book is really cheering me up.
Well, that's good. You know, I'm not used to praise of any kind. Are you enjoying it?
I was just wondering how much of it is true and how much of it's made up.
Every bit of it is
not
true.
Not a word, Andy. Not a word.
Everybody. Well,
no, I would say, Andy.
I just had to turn him off there. It's all true. There's not a word there that has been exaggerated, and there's not a word there that has been made up, and there's not an incident recalled that did not happen, and there's not a thought there that is not genuine. I happen to believe that when you write a book, it will be there. See, whenever you make radio programs, no one will ever listen to this radio program in 10 or 15 years' time. And if you make any television programs, when they look back on them, they'd only laugh at your tie. Right? A book is the only thing that lasts. When I am dead and gone, if I may quote McGinnis Flint, yes. When I am dead and gone, the only thing that will be left that anyone will listen to or even notice are books. So in 50 years' time, somebody will come along and they lift up books and go, let's just read that. Now, and you're lying dead, right? And would it be terrible if it was a load of lies? So everything that I write is true.
Do you want me to ask you one or two?
You go ask. Go on ahead. I have nothing to fear. Everything that I write is true.
The dog on the boat.
That's absolutely
not
true.
Not at all.
I haven't got that far yet.
Oh, it's all right then. Well, okay. Yes, you must. That's at the start
it's
of the book.
It's absolutely true.
That's at the start of the book.
It's not at the start of the book.
Is it not?
No. And it's absolutely true. How dare you call me a liar?
What about the incidents with the inhalers?
Absolutely true.
Grossly exaggerated.
Absolutely true. Oh, you knew you went there.
Grossly exaggerated.
The only thing you ever took was an Aspro and you thought that was high living. Some of the most exotic things that I've done, he doesn't believe I've done them because he would never consider doing them. There's things that I do that he would never do in a million years. Therefore, when I do them, he doesn't believe I've done them because he wouldn't do them. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Things that happens to you and you don't know why they happen, and but then when you look back you can see why it happened.
What are you talking about?
I'm getting to it. Beverly D'Angelo, she came here to make a movie in Dublin called High Spirits along with Peter O'Toole and people like that, and she lived for a while.
You're doing that with your mouth again?
I know, I'm sorry. There's something wrong with my mouth.
It's very old.
There's something wrong with me. No, what happens is I've chipped my tooth.
Well, yes, you should stop.
It's chipped me tooth.
It's a sign of age.
I've chipped me tooth and it's sticking into my cheek here and I'm trying to free it.
Emma wants to know what you do. He fitters with his tongue and his mouth and he does that, you know, like an old man.
Why don't you look at him and you can see me doing
his plate,
it?
You know what I mean? And his mouth.
She won't look at me.
Well, no, just get a look at your plate. Go anyway, on, show Emma what you do now.
She didn't like that.
No.
Anyway, she was making a movie in Dublin called High Spirits. And while she was here, she did a TV program in Belfast, which I was involved in. And I had to interview her. And did you ever meet someone and you just had an immediate bond?
No.
Never?
No.
Did you ever meet someone and suddenly you just bonded with them immediately? Like
Jerry Kelly. I suppose it was the last person I bonded with.
No, I kind of mean, you know,
what?
A woman, you know. I know you bond with men, but do you ever meet a woman and just really bonded? Not in any kind of lecherous sense, but you just felt as if you were one. Did you ever meet that? Did you ever get that?
No.
No, but see, that's because you're not normal. Anyway, I met her and there was kind of a spark between us. And she's this famous movie star and I'm just me, you know. And we were chatting away and it was just wonderful. And she said to me later, she said, we must meet again. And it never happened. And then afterwards...
She says that to everyone. She'd probably say it to Eamon Holmes.
Well, she wouldn't say it to Eamon Holmes. He'd be afraid.
Yeah.
Eamon Holmes, you know, a very shy person. I always thought that Eamon was involved in that show, now that you mention it. Eamon was very strange, you know. Women used to like Eamon.
Don't know the fella at all.
Do you not?
No.
Eamon's a nice guy.
Never met him.
I always figured that Eamon should have been a priest. No, yeah. I really do think that.
Yeah, yeah.
Because whenever we were doing this particular programme in Belfast years ago that Beverly D'Angelo was on, I used to kind of, I would be with him, you know, in kind of restaurants and things like that. Do you know
who?
Eamon Holmes. Oh. But everywhere he went, see, Eamon was a very, very good-looking guy. Very slim and very good looking, very dark. He was kind of like, not kind of George Best thing going for a while. Women used to flock to him. He used to come over and they used to sit down and talk to him and stuff. You know, really good looking women. And he used to get all red.
Yeah, rightly so.
No, but I used to say,
taking your soup and some.
I used to say, here, come on over here, talk to me. I don't get red. I never get red. Come on over here.
I'm a non-huggable person.
No, but you see, yes, well, to look at, yes. But you see, the fact is, it's not that you're unhuggable.
I
mean, people can hug you.
No, but I can't.
If you say you're unhuggable, it means that you can't be hugged.
What I'm saying is
you're not a hugger.
I'm not a hugger. I go
look
rigid.
At Ken. Practice on Ken. Let Sean hug you there.
No. Go on,
he's nice.
I'm not bad.
He's nice and plump. Ken.
Plump Ken. No, I don't like it at all.
No, it's because of the way you've been brought up. You see, we were brought up not to show emotion. But I got over that because I went away from home. You see, whenever you go away from home and live other places, you learn it's okay to show emotions. But remember what it was like when we grew up here. Derry, Stoke, London, Derry. Yeah. Everything was grey. Do you remember if you had to get a red shirt, you had a flight in Naples? Mm. And everything was grey and cars were grey and ships were grey and clothes were grey and people were grey. People's complexion. The broom was grey. Everything was grey. The walls were grey.
Remember it was grey getting coloured lining in your suit? You thought you were doing something
different? No, you thought... You thought it was somehow wrong to get coloured. Remember you used to get a kind of a satin thing in your suit?
I had yellow lining on.
You're a big boy.
Bold.
You see, we were discouraged. Now, I don't know about you, but my parents were lovely, but they weren't hugging people.
No.
Because they weren't brought up to hug people. My mother was brought up in the country, and she was a very affectionate person, but they weren't brought up to show affection. And my father, do you know, my father wouldn't speak to me in the street.
I told you about that before.
He used to stand up at the corner with all his friends and
but
spit.
But men are going overboard now with hugs.
Men are hugging each other.
That's what I mean. Men are hugging.
There was a time when you'd turn the corner if you saw that.
I know.
Men are kissing each other and everything.
It's not good.
It's great. No, but you should learn to go with the flow. You should go to Italy for a while. Stay there for a while. Live there for a couple of months and watch how the men hug each other. And they go, in a bit belly, what you find? And you hey, Sean. Hey.
I don't know where to look. That's my problem.
Look over their shoulders.
No, but what do you do?
You saw me hugging Phil Coulter one day. You criticised me for that because you complained that Phil didn't respond. But you see, the point was that my love was there. Phil didn't have the love in him. He walked in with his big hat on and I threw my arms around and gave him a big smack.
But it's hard for a man to hug another man with a hat on.
Well, you see, that's
not your rhythm gets in the way.
That was him choose to put the hat on. I mean, if I had had my way, I'd have flung it off him. But I put my arms around him, give him a big hug. But he was stiff, wasn't he?
Yes.
He was wooden. And you're the same. You're stiff and wooden.
Yeah, I am no good.
I've seen you. Yes. I've observed you.
I'm no good
hugging
at all.
And Brian Kennedy comes in. Brian always hugs me.
Yes.
That's as far as I go. You know, the first date. And he hugs you as well, but you don't like it.
I don't like it at all.
And I've seen you squirming.
Yes. But even with girls, I don't like it.
No, but you see, this is what I can't understand.
I don't like it.
You see, you should regard it, if a girl comes over and hugs you, you should regard that as your boat coming in. But you don't regard that as your boat coming in at all. You regard that as an ordeal to be got through. It's the way you were brought up.
I just like to nod my head and say, how you doing?
It's all them priests.
I'm a nodder. I prefer to nod.
No, you're a handshaker.
I'm a handshaker. I like handshaking.
Ah, how you doing, boy?
I was introduced to a girl on Saturday night and we shook hands. And I said to her, he said, so well. Yes. I shook her hand. She put her hand out and I shook her hand. And I said, you have a good firm handshake. I like that. And it was that wrong?
Yes, it was.
And she said to me, thank you. But I liked her hand.
You said to a girl, you've got a good firm handshake, love. Oh, she'll enjoy that.
I liked your hands.
She'll go home and she'll say it to somebody and they'll say, do you know what he was trying to say to you? I'm not going to say it.
No, but I liked her.
You've got a man's handshake, love.
There's been a request for you to do your horn.
No, I hate doing that.
It's never been the same. It has never been the same.
See, I got it right the first time.
Is no good.
Not everybody can. I know, I'd like to hear you doing it. Go on.
I can't do it.
Don't complain. Go on.
Do you hold your nose?
You do whatever you like.
You're jealous practicing in the corner quietly.
That's not a horn. That's nothing. You have to get a...
Ah, you're using a prop. He's using a prop. You're using a prop. You can't do that. You're using a rolled up. Stop it. He's using a rolled up piece of paper.
Are you going to that outside broadcast on Thursday?
I don't know.
I hope not.
No.
Well,
there's
anyway.
There's not a lot for me to do.
No, that's all the more reason why you should be there. We did it last year. Did I do it last year? No, I didn't do it last year. I was away. You should know you were here.
But I wasn't there to be here.
But I'll be here until I go. And then when I do go, I'll be away. Well, but before I go, I'll be here.
You won't.
Well, I won't be here. I'll be there.
No, you'll only be here once.
Before I go away, I won't be here, but I will
be
there.
You'll be here once before
I'll be
you
there
go
before
away.
I go away, but I'll be here first before I'm there before I go away. You got
yes,
that?
Yes, yes, yes. Only once, but...
Who was the most famous man that we ever introduced in the John Hewitt? And he wasn't famous then.
It's Boxcar. Steve Sickcar Woolley.
Sickbag Woolley. Yeah, Sickbag Woolley. Yeah, he was... Sickbag Woolley. Seasick Steve. I'm going to tell him Sickbag Woolley.
An awful thing to call him.
Sick bag, Willie. That's the best you've ever come up with. Okay, we introduced for the first time to the general public a fantastic musician with a beard and a guitar, and we didn't know what he was going to be like at the time, and he was great. And I had the privilege of saying, ladies and gentlemen, for the first time ever, please put your hands together for Sick Bag Willie.
A song I hate, and people try to sing it, and every time they sing it, they say, I'm going to sing the song the way it should be sung.
Oh, which one is that?
And they all sing it the same.
Which song is that?
Summertime and the living is easy. Yeah. And they all, you know.
And you go, oh,
fish are jumping, and the cotton is high.
I've got you. Under my skin, I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart, you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. Why does everybody sing like that? Hey, did you happen to see the most beautiful girl that walked out on me? Tell her I love her. She can sing any song in that kind of way.
Yeah.
Give us another. Something in the way she moved attracts me like no other lover. Hey, something in the way she moves me.
What about yesterday?
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away.
Hard
now
song.
All my troubles... No, that's great.
It's a hard song to sing in that.
I believe in yesterday. You have to kind of half talk to make it jazzy.
Does Jerry still have a tape called Our Boys 1957? And would he play some of it, please? Because you're in that. 1957,
do you know what that is? Do you know what that is? That is the greatest tape ever. You're whispering again under your breath.
I'm working out what age you were in 1957.
Don't do that, please. You know as well as I was five. I was five.
You were five?
Five. There's a
no, you weren't. Don't say that's the wrong age. You weren't born.
Oh, sorry, I wasn't born. I wasn't born at all. I wasn't on the tape.
Five makes you very old if you were five in 1957.
That's not good, that, is it? That's not good, no. No.
Eh?
Was that 52?
Is that what it was? Janet says you were nine.
That's right, Janet, thanks. I was nine.
1957.
See, what happened was every year...
Three and nine.
Can you stop doing those sums? I hate it when you do sums. What happened was...
How do you know he was nine, Janet?
She looked at the rings in me teeth. Stop it, will you? Stop talking about my age. I don't like it. You know it makes me nervous. Because you might guess it probably.
Nine.
Anyway, well, you promised to stop talking about this.
All right.
I was at the Christian Brothers. You can tell I'm a Christian brother because every time somebody shouts my name, I duck. Go on, do it.
No.
Anderson.
Anyway, every year there was a concert. All the boys used to take part. And I took part in a sketch. It was called The Gingerbread House. I played the part of the girl. My name is Cathy. And I had a wee skirt and all. Do you know how long it took me to live that down?
You probably idea? Still have the took skirt.
Took me 10 years to live that down. But the thing was, one of the fellas who was in that sketch, and I won't give you his name because he was a witch. He said to me, he said, there's a great tape of that whole concert circulating around, a cassette tape. And he said, I said, is our gingerbread house on it? He said, no, no, no. The gymnastics is on it. I said, what? He said, do you remember the gymnastic display? I said, yeah. I said, we had no part of that. He said, it was great, but remember. I said, were you in that? He said, yes. Well, I wasn't in it because I was puny. He said, the gymnastics display was great. He said, that's on the tape. I said, what do you mean it's on the tape? He said, you can hear it. And I said, I have to have a copy of that. So I made inquiries and a man gave me the copy of the thing. I put it on. Do you want to hear what it was like? This is the tape. That's people clapping, right?
Yes. That's the gymnastics.
Do you want to hear it again?
But slow coming down that time.
It was higher. But we see when they put the bar up. This is the high jump.
They're doing a high jump in gymnastics.
No, I just made that up. Going to read a Seamus Heaney poem. You didn't realise he wrote Bang Bang, did you?
What, the shares?
I was five and he was six. We rode on horses made of sticks. He wore black, I wore white. He would always win the fight, being physically stronger, of course, you understand. Bang, bang. He shot me down. Bang, bang. I hit the ground. Bang, bang. That awful sound. Bang, bang. My baby shot me down. When I say baby, I don't mean a small child. I'm talking about when a man and a woman go together in America and they say, oh, hello, baby. I love you, baby. Come over here, baby. Sit on my knee, baby. They're not actually talking about an actual baby, you understand. It's a term of affection and endearment. Seasons came and changed the time. When I grew up, I called him mine. He would always laugh and say, remember when we used to play bang, bang? I shot you down, bang, bang. You hit the ground, bang, bang. That awful sound, bang, bang. I used to shoot you down. When he's talking shoot you down, he's talking about, for instance, when a man goes with a woman and a woman decides no longer to, that she no longer enjoys his company, she would, so to speak, shoot him down. I'm sure, Mr. Coyle, you've often been shot down yourself.
Oh, I was shot
especially
down.
Especially in dances, you'd say, well, would you like to dance, dear? And she would shoot you down by saying, no, thanks.
I was shot down more time than the Germans.
Music played and the people sang. Just for me, the church bell sang. Now he's gone, I don't know why. Until this day, sometimes I cry. He didn't even say goodbye. He didn't take the time to even lie. Bang, bang. He shot me down, bang, bang. I hit the ground, bang, bang. The awful sound, bang, bang. My baby shot me down.
Remember, there was a time you were sent to the shop for half a pound of butter. Or a pound of butter?
That time is still here.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
It's all in tubs now.
No, 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 that's the old horrible stuff. You still get the half a pound of the pound. That's the traditional butter. The tub is the stuff easily spreadable, and they say it's real butter, but it's not. Because even you put it in the frying pan, if you're doing a sausage, it disappears completely. Do you know when you put a knob of butter in the saucepan, and it spreads around, it goes, oh, come and bring me a sausage. And then you drop a sausage down, and it goes, and it cooks your sausage lovely, and you eat it. See, if you do that with the stuff in the tub, it just goes, then you put the sausage down and sticks the pan and goes, let me up, let me up. This is not real butter, let me up out of this pan.
Well, we eat.
Hear me doing a sausage there? I don't think anyone has ever impersonated a sausage in Radio Ulster before. Will I do it again?
Yeah.
Let me up out of this pan. What? I'm a pork sausage. Do you know where you get good butter? Go to one of those farms. You know those guys who kind of...
I don't like butter.
Oh, sorry, I thought I just assumed that you did.
I don't like butter because it tastes like butter.
There's no way around that. The last word from Rosie Ryan from Clougher, mother of the rapidly deteriorating Bon Jovi, Enfant Terrible. Hello,
Enchantress here. When I heard you were running the New York Marathon, my heart swelled with pride and my knees turned into a substance that reminded me of Chivers Jelly. Jerry Anderson, 26 miles, said my son, Bon Jovi. That does not compute. I fear Uncle Jerry may succumb to fatigue and lie down on the road like roadkill. Rubbish, was my retort. Jerry has run before from the law and crowds of angry dancers looking for their money back after singing his little song. Jerry, I am knitting you a pair of running drawers. It's the least I can do. The drawers will come down to below your knee and I've chosen the colour white. When the drawers are knitted, I will embroider them with green shamrocks around the fork and on the back, a likeness of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, our late president. There will be two pockets to hold your fags and mobile phone. You don't want to be restricted when running, so there will be ample room around the fork. Pace yourself, Jerry. A marathon is all about pace. And liquids are very important. On a week before the race, drink a bottle of vodka a day to fend off dehydration. This can be upped to a bottle and a half on the day of the race if you feel nervous. I will send the drawers up to you by parcel force, so hang around the house to sign for them. Thank you for listening. Until next week, from me, Jerry Anderson, goodbye.